radio spirit world, interdimensional.
Radio spirit world, interdimensional.
Radio Geisterwelt, interdimensional.
Radio Spirit World, interdim.
This is Radio Spirit World, interdimensional, broadcasting to the living world from the other side. On 6.22 megahertz in the 49-meter band shortwave and selected Ouija boards.
Hello, and welcome to The Other Side, your weekly roundup of news and views and just about everything that's going on in the afterlife. I'm Florestan Hutt.
And I'm Eusebius Entwinkle. And we're broadcasting to you dead from the spirit world.
And boy, do we have a jam-packed show for you.
We'll be reading some of your letters.
We'll be meeting the late William Shakespeare.
And of course, some fabulous studio guests.
But don't forget the competition, Eusebius.
How could I? Well, that's all to come.
But first, the news headlines. The late actor Peter Ustinov has been arrested again for poltergeist activities. The former wit and raconteur caused nearly £200,000 worth of damage at a McDonald's restaurant in West London. Ustinov smashed tables and chairs, filled mayonnaise dispensers with ectoplasm, and changed the sign to read McUstinov. If found guilty, McUstinov could face up to an infinity behind bars.
John F. Kennedy has finally revealed the truth behind his death in 1963. Speaking at a press conference yesterday, the late American president revealed that he had actually committed suicide.
I had a tiny pistol, which I had gotten specially made, and which I then concealed in my mouth. And at the prescribed time, when the car was level with the book depository, I pulled the trigger with my tongue.
Mr. Kennedy went on to apologize to his wife and family for the years of anguish and called the man accused of his assassination, Lee Harvey Oswald, a true American hero.
The great-great-great-great-great-grandparents of the popular singer Amy Winehouse have issued a statement saying that they strongly disapprove of her lifestyle and wild behavior. Herman and Lillian Winehouse said that their great-great-great-great-great-granddaughter had caused them much heartache and that they would be having strong words with Miss Winehouse when she crosses over to the other side in just over 2 weeks.
The ban on smoking in the afterlife comes into effect at exactly 12 million hours tonight. After nearly a century of debate, the Central Council passed a law which prohibits smoking in all zones and citadels. Peter Hennessy, the leader of the CCCC, CCCP, the Citizens' Constitutional Campaign for Cigars, Cigarettes, Cigarillos, Cheroots and Pipes, was disappointed by the decision.
I think it's disgraceful, especially when you consider that smoking in the afterlife has absolutely no ill effects whatsoever.
The one area where the new law does not apply is hell, where smoking is compulsory.
And finally, the late Egyptian pharaoh Tutankhamun has been named Best Dressed Man at the Afterlife Style Awards. The star-studded ceremony, hosted by Princess Diana and Adolf Hitler, also saw a Lifetime Achievement Award going to the inventor of the loincloth, Ugga Ugga.
Mr. Meisterwerk und Herr Verlinger, danke schön, Herr Ugga Ugga.
Ugga Ugga, happy.
And that's the news on The Other Side.
did you die?
I died in my sleep.
I was hanged for treason.
I had diabetes.
I had a heart attack at the Battle of Hastings.
How did you die?
I died of a broken heart and fell into a crusher.
Thomas Edison stabbed me.
We drowned.
How did you die?
Old age.
Old age.
Old age.
Old age.
How did you die?
I was hanged, but apparently I died of natural causes just moments before the actual hanging. So I suppose I put down natural causes and hanging.
I ate some infected feces.
I was abandoned on a submarine and I rotted away.
That is so interesting, listening to all the different ways that people have died.
Isn't it just? There's such a variety.
And it's got me thinking, Eusebius, in all the time we've known each other, I've never asked you, how did you die?
Well, that's a good question, Florestan. I was out in the woods with my falcon one day, and something scared it, possibly a highwayman, and it flew off. Anyway, I went looking for the bird, and unfortunately slipped and fell down a well.
Oh, I'm sorry to hear that.
It was very painful, as I'd broken most of the bones in my body, my back, my neck. There was no way of getting out. So I lived on worms, beetles, a bit of moss. I was very unhappy, and I slowly withered away. And then, on about the 30th day, someone dropped a big rock on my head.
So I suppose that finished you off.
It certainly did. And what about you, Florestan? How did you die?
Well, I'm afraid I haven't got as good a story as yours, Eusebius. I just burned to death in a house fire.
One, two. This is Biggie Spong. I want to send a quick shout out to Florestan and Eusebius. Yeah. One, two, and the shit don't stop. In the afterlife, I still rock the mic. Rock the mic in the afterlife. Yeah, Radio Spirit World. Florestan and Eusebius. 622 megahertz shortwave, motherfucker.
Face to face. This week we meet a very special lady who has an incredible talent, for she can play every single instrument known to mankind. But one thing, she has never played any of them. Intrigued? Hello, Anne Hardinge.
Hello.
I understand that you are somewhat of a musical prodigy.
Yes, well, when I crossed over to the other side, I had an immensely strong feeling that I could play every single musical instrument much better than anybody who has ever lived.
And you say this was just a feeling?
Yes, a very strong feeling, although I'd never picked up an instrument or played one. And furthermore, I've never had an interest in music. In fact, I've always found it rather annoying. So this was really all the more surprising.
So you could play, for example, the harpsichord better than Johann Sebastian Bach?
Oh, certainly, yes.
Well, we have a surprise for you, because here in the studio we have a fine harpsichord which was made in 1744 by Hochstein, and we would very much like you to play some harpsichord music for us.
Well, although I have an immensely strong feeling that I would be able to play this better than any person who has ever lived, I somehow feel that to demonstrate my incredible skill would somehow seem, in a funny sort of way, vulgar.
But I can promise you that we will not find it vulgar, far be it from that. We will probably find it absolutely ravishing and gorgeous.
Well, I'm afraid I must decline your offer. I really, really would rather that I didn't play what's it called?
The harpsichord.
The harpsichord.
I must beseech you one more time, Anne Hardinge, play for us.
Well, I rather feel that I'm being pressured into playing this instrument, and I don't really have a choice.
Well, I'm glad you're beginning to see the light, as it were. Here is the instrument, and if you would like to take your seat and begin to play.
Right. This.
You'll need to face the other way.
Oh, and...
And open the lid.
These are the buttons, are they?
They're the harpsichord keys.
Right. Well, I've thought it through, and I'm afraid I'm going to have to say no.
Well, we are really very disappointed. All I can say is it is a terrible shame, and it's been a pleasure meeting you, and I wish I could say it was a pleasure hearing you play. And thank you very much, Anne Hardinge.
Well, perhaps I could play.
Thank you very much. That'll be wonderful for you. Thank you very much. I really do appreciate it.
So, something like this? How is that?
Oh, that is beautiful. Well, you're beautiful.
Oh.
How did it feel playing that?
I can't say that I enjoyed it because, as I said, I don't enjoy music. I find it rather tedious and noisy, really.
Well, if it's noisiness that you're not so keen on, we do have some other instruments in the room. How do you feel about playing these drums?
Well, I suppose so, yes.
Remarkable. And Hardinge is playing the drums with just one hand. Fantastic. And now she's playing the harpsichord with the other. And I don't believe it. She's now playing the violin with her foot, the viola with her knee, saxophone with her vagina, and the penny whistle with her nose. Incredible. Bravo! Bravo, Anne. Bravo. That really was something, Anne. Do you think you're going to take up any of these instruments in the future?
I must say, of all the instruments, I really enjoyed the saxophone.
Isn't music wonderful, Florestan?
Yes, it is, Eusebius. What music have you been listening to recently?
I've been listening to the new collaboration between John Lennon and the Vikings. It's wonderful. Songs of the Sea and Revolution. And what about you, Florestan?
Oh, Phil Collins. I'd love to meet him. I can't wait for him to die.
Postbag. Postbag.
Postbag.
Postbag.
Postbag.
This week we receive hundreds of letters and messages from people all across the world back on Earth, and we thank you for it. Unfortunately, we could only answer a few of your queries, but we do thank you all.
And here's our first letter. It's from Mrs. Patty Ogugwa from Nairobi, Kenya, and she writes...
Dear Postbag, do animal spirits travel over to the other side?
Well, indeed they do, Patty, but when animals die, they go to their own special dimension. However, some animal spirits are allowed to live side by side with human spirits, namely dogs and cats, rattlesnakes, pigeons, worms, cockroaches, and head lice.
Now here's a telephone message from Mr. Simon Lancaster in Perth, Australia.
Oh, hi, Radio Spirit World. I'm a regular listener. And my question for you, Postbag, is can you see us? Can you see us from where you are? Okay, well, thank you for answering my question. Keep up the good work. Goodbye.
Well, Simon, thank you for your kind words. Yes, we can see you, very much so, whatever you're doing. And I do mean whatever you're doing. In fact, watching the living is one of the main pastimes in the afterlife. Would you agree, Florestan?
Oh, yes, most definitely. I like watching people having disagreements. You can catch a pretty good argument every now and then.
Well, I'm more of a romantic. I like watching couples kissing.
Oh, I quite like that, but I prefer it when they start having sexual intercourse.
Oh, I don't like that at all. I do get a bit embarrassed.
Oh, Eusebius. My favorite is watching people masturbate. I love it. It's so funny.
Yes, it is rather funny, isn't it?
But I suppose it depends on who you're watching.
You like watching that big fat man, don't you?
Oh, him! I was watching him this morning. He was in the bath. It was hilarious.
Hello, this is former President of Iraq, Saddam Hussein, inviting you all to my Sunday jukebox, when my guests will be Buddy Holly and Beethoven. That's Sunday jukebox at 900,000 hours on Radio Spirit World. Long live the people of Iraq.
And now it's time for Spirit Box, where you, the listeners, get to hear messages from loved ones and colleagues who have crossed over to the other side.
This week's messages come from spirits who are in Vortex number 4, which lies parallel to the twin zones of Citadina 9 and Citadella 14. Perhaps you recognize one of these voices yourself.
Let's take a listen.
This is Lee Margoyle. I'm leaving this message for my family. Please don't touch any of my stuff.
Hello, this is Michael Barlisle with a message of love for his wonderful daughter, Jenny. And we just wanted to say that when you do pass over, you will be with us and your entire family. We have our own room, and you will be there with your mother and I, your grandparents, great-grandparents, your great-great-grandparents, stretching back 500, 600 years of all your relatives and family, all in one room together, in one room for eternity. So, my darling, it is really something to look forward to. And we hope to see you when you're ready. I love you. We love you.
Hello. Hello, Kitty. Where are you? Where am I? I love you. Where are you? Where am I? I love you.
Billy Turner is a thief.
Hello, this is Paul Hubbard from the Isle of Wight. I've got a message for anyone that knows me. And it's something to get off my chest. In my life, I stole about 2,000 wheelchairs.
And we have just received an urgent message from Mrs. Pauline Flynn of Doncaster, England, who is currently on holiday in Crete. I repeat, an urgent message from Mrs. Pauline Flynn of Doncaster, who is holidaying in Crete. Mrs. Flynn, your house is about to be destroyed in a gas explosion. It's the hottest ticket in the afterlife, and everyone who is anyone is hoping to get one. Yes, tomorrow night sees the opening of the first new play by the late, great William Shakespeare for almost 400 years. It's called Elizabeth II, and already they're queuing around the block. I caught up with the very talented Mr. Shakespeare to find out a bit more about his latest work. Hello, Mr. Shakespeare.
Hello.
It's great to meet you, and how are you?
I'm dead, thank you, and how are you?
Very dead indeed. Now, the play revolves around a young band called the Bitter Penises, trying to make it in the cut-and-thrust world of the music industry.
Yes, that's right.
And why did you decide to call the band the Bitter Penises?
The play deals with themes of disillusionment and male sexuality, so the band name, the Bitter Penises, seemed apt. And also, there were two words I've always wanted to put together, and now I have.
One of the most controversial aspects of the play is the use of bad language. For instance, the word shit appears many times throughout the play, as do the words asshole, bastard, and prick, as well as 26 instances of the F-word, fuck.
Well, I wanted to use really dirty language because writing can be quite boring, and so whenever I use one of those words, it livens the whole thing up for me.
And in a nutshell, Mr. Shakespeare, can you tell us a little bit about the plot of Elizabeth II?
Certainly. It's Friday night, and the Bitter Penises are about to play their biggest gig ever. Unfortunately, their bass player, Johnny Tight Jeans, fractures his arm in a fall. And so the Bitter Penises have no choice but to escape Earth and to travel into space, more specifically to Saturn, where they're greeted by Themidor, the overseer of the gas giants, who then tricks them and enslaves them for 500 years until his death, when they escape, fly through a black hole, which in turn becomes a white hole, and the Bitter Penises land right back at the concert hall 2 minutes before they are meant to go on. But this time, they all have fractured arms and fractured penises, and so the gig is cancelled.
And that's all in the first 5 minutes.
Well, it's actually in the first 4 minutes.
Mr. Shakespeare, how long did it take you to write the play?
Well, I wrote it pretty quickly, using a special technique, which is to write all the letters alphabetically as the first draft, and then for the second and final draft, to rearrange all the letters into the words and the order I want them to appear in. It's how I wrote Hamlet.
Finally, Mr. Shakespeare, do you have any plans for further plays?
Well, yes. I'm currently writing a follow-up to my play, King Lear.
Could you tell us a little bit about the plot, perhaps?
Certainly. The plot revolves around a band called the Bitter Penises, who are about to perform at a very important concert. One day, their keyboard player, Johnny Lipgloss, fractures his leg, and so the Bitter Penises have to escape Earth and travel to Jupiter, where they are enslaved by Tharson, the new overseer of the gas giants. And it's not until 500 years that they escape via a black hole, which becomes a white hole, and the Bitter Penises land right back at the concert venue, only minutes before they were meant to go on stage. But this time, they all have fractured legs and fractured penises. But the gig does go on.
Well, Mr. Shakespeare, I wish you all the best with Elizabeth II and your new play. And on a personal note, I do hope your fractured arm, fractured leg and fractured penis get better soon.
Oh, thank you very much.
And now it's time for this week's Lucky Dip.
As usual, we have the names of three listeners who will be crossing over to the other side in the next 7 days. And they've each won a terrific prize. Is your name on the list? Well, let's find out.
The names are Jacques Lamprier, Michel Tang, and Suggs.
Congratulations to you all. You've each won yourself a VIP tour of our studios, plus a fantastic Radio Spirit World shroud. So, see you next week. Well, that really was a terrific program, wasn't it, Florestan?
Yes, it was a real knockout, even if I do say so myself.
But all good things have to come to an end, my friend.
Yes, and, well, that's all we have time for this time. But don't forget to tune in next time to The Other Side.
There'll be more letters and competitions.
We'll have a special report on the reopening of hell after much of it was destroyed by a terrible fire.
And Winston Churchill will be joining us dead in the studio to tell us all about his new life as a male prostitute.
I'll look forward to that.
Me too.
So, from me, Florestan Hutt.
And me, Eusebius Entwinkle.
It's goodbye from the other side.
If you would like to contact Radio Spirit World, here's how.
Call us on 00000-414-04, 220317, 7002, 029-9907, 461-660423, 0800-8888. That number again, 00-00-00-414-04-22034-229-9907-4619-9907-461-660-43-0800-8888. Or contact us by post by writing a letter in blood and then burning it.
Radio Spirit World is now closing down. So wherever you are, we would like to wish you a pleasant and peaceful night. Do sleep well. In victor, in vartarium, ventor, tormentus.
Radio Spirit World was written and performed by Robert Popper and Peter Serafinowicz. The Radio Spirit World studio engineer was Sam Roberts.